Hi everyone, hello and welcome to DrupalCon. Also, I would like to welcome you to my talk, Custom Elements and Alternate Render API for Decoupled Drupal. So let's start with a short introduction about me. My name is Wolfgang Ziegler, or I'm Fargo on Drupal.org. I'm CEO and CTO of Tronomics, a company situated in Vienna. We have around 10 developers. You might know me from one of my contributions. So I've worked a lot on the Drupal 8 Entity API and also on the type data core system. I've also contributed quite some modules, in particular like Drupal 7 modules, like the rules module or the Entity API module you might know, also field collection and profile 2. You find me under the little Fargo at Twitter or Fargo at Drupal.org. So before we go into the details with my session, let's elaborate a little bit on why you would like or you might want to decouple Drupal. So for us at my company, Tronomics, like the main goals really were like to have like an independent front-end development so that actually front-end developers don't have to know any details about Drupal, how to debug things in Twig and to work with all the Drupal data structures and all those things. They really should be able to focus on the front-end, know the front-end tools, and that's it. And the second thing that was and is really important for us is to actually to have reusable front-end components so that a front-end component is basically standalone. It can come with its own assets, its dependencies for JavaScript and CSS, and also to be able to package them in a reusable fashion. So like that's a solved problem with all those modern front-end development tools, but it's actually pretty hard to do in an efficient and good way with Drupal. So I've also wrote a blog post about that. I don't want to go into too much detail here, but if you're interested, you can also check out my blog post. You find it on our company blog. Then like once we're decoupling, you might wonder, okay, now why decouple with custom elements? So, and the reason for that is that we don't want to throw away all of the Drupal's nice features. So we want to decouple for being able to have the modern front-end development and for the reasons as shown before, but we want to keep all the features that Drupal has as much as possible. So for example, routing, path resolution, and URL alias handling is something that we want to keep. Editorial control of pages and layouts, cookie-based authentication, but also stuff like all the caching mechanism and features Drupal provides, or like previews and forms would be also good to integrate with Drupal nicely. Finally, with custom elements, it's quite easy to render on the client side. So since custom elements are part of the web component specification, you can also do web components of it, but it's also very easily integrates with modern JavaScript frameworks like Vue.js and React. So to take some concrete example right in the beginning, if you're not so much experienced with custom elements, this is how a custom element would look like. And these are actually examples of some paragraphs and how they would be described with a custom element. So in this example, it's a Twitter paragraph. Here we have the custom element name, PG Twitter. It can have some attributes like the source attribute of a tweet. And it can have some nested markup. So that's working with slots. So each slot just has nested markup. And since it's markup, it can also contain more nested custom elements. Like another example would be here a quote. So it's a quote element. It has a title slot with a random title. And then actually the main content is just nested in the custom element, which automatically becomes the default slot. And then there was also like a slot for the author name. So I hope it's now clear what we're talking about when I refer to like a custom element. But now actually what's really nice about working with custom elements is now when we use the custom elements everywhere, we render all our content in Drupal into custom elements. It automatically also means that we have components everywhere. So that's really nice, like for front-end and design workflow, which is component oriented. Before we go a little bit more in depth, I also want to provide a little bit more context, a little bit of history. So first, the company Tronomics, we started like about 2 years ago developing our in-house distribution, Lupus Digital Publishing, which basically is a publishing distribution based upon Funder that we use to kickstart our projects. And with that distribution, we also started building our favorite decoupled stack. And that's since that, we are really working on the stack and with custom elements. And we have it in use since that and really like working with it. But right now, we actually decoupled the stack and say like, okay, let's take just all the parts that are really necessary for the decoupled setup and make sure they are working together, they are contributed as open source modules and packages so that everyone can just very easily work with that decoupled stack. So in our situation, we decided for going with Nuxt.js in the front end, which is just really convenient combination. It's a Vue.js based framework. And obviously Drupal with the custom elements modules in the backend. So how does that actually look like from a bird eye view? So in case a user on the browser accesses a path like /home with server side rendering, the request will go to a Node.js server running Nuxt.js. Then the Nuxt.js server, it will just forward the request to the API backend. In our case, we actually really like to just have Drupal run on the /API subpath. So it's just very convenient to forward the requests to Drupal. Drupal takes over the routing and page resolution. It renders the page in custom element markup and it returns the custom element markup to the Nuxt.js server. The Nuxt.js is rendering that custom element markup into HTML and returns it to the user. Then for static pages, it's also possible in Nuxt.js to, instead of run in, with a server, to just pre-render all the pages and to put it on a server. So in that case, when a user would access /home, the user will just grab the statically pre-rendered files from the server, and that's it. So that way you can also run sites like using a Jamstack approach if you like. But then for subsequent page loads, what happens with the client-side framework is that Nuxt.js is already loaded in the browser. So any subsequent page load can leverage client-side navigation, and the browser will just directly fetch the API from Drupal. So it will directly go to /API, whatever path is entered. In that example, it just the user clicked on an example article. Again, Drupal will process the response, return the custom element markup to the browser in this case, which then takes over the rendering. So with static mode, actually, you can do it the same. So the Nuxt can actually statically save the payload from those API responses. Or you can also basically disable that and just go with all the pre-rendered HTML pages. So what Drupal modules do you need in the backend for making this possible? As mentioned, like the main module for that is the custom elements module. So the custom elements module, it really takes care of the data representation. It provides a custom element class, and based upon that custom element class, the data is represented as a nested tree of custom element objects. How does that look like? So for example, if a node would be rendered using custom elements, the object tree could look like this. So we have a wrapping custom element just called node in this example. Each custom element has some attributes. So we have here the type attribute, which contains the content type, the title, and also like the publishing flag status. Then, as mentioned, there are the slots for the nested custom elements. So there is like a slot hero, which contains a paragraph image and all the attributes needed for that custom element. Then there are multiple further default slots, which just text paragraphs with some text. And then there's a special slot for the tags field, which just contains all the reference tags. So this would be an example on how you can render a very simple page using custom elements and how it would look like in the custom element object tree. You would have one parent custom element object with nested objects for the PG image, the PG text elements, and so on. For generating the custom element objects, the module actually provides sensible defaults for rendering entities and the fields based on view modes already into the custom element object tree. So the rendering actually happens with so-called custom element processors. And the module just provides a bunch of default processors, which provide really sensible defaults, but obviously you can customize that. And that customization is something that typically developers do, not themers, because the themers, they just work on the front-end side. So the front-end developers don't touch Drupal. And since that's prepared by developers, also doesn't make much sense to use templates or something like that. So instead of that, we figured it's better to create an API which works like the Symfony serialization or normalization API, in case you know that. So how does that work? So you create a new service for your processor and you register it in your module services YAML file. In this example, we implement a processor for the Twitter paragraph. You just register the service as usual, and then you tag it with the custom elements processor tag, and you may also set a priority on it. So the higher the priority, the more likely it gets chosen. Like the highest priority one actually then will render and process the data and generate the custom element. So the class will have to implement the custom element processor interface. It has a supports method, which is there for figuring out which class should actually render some data. So the supports method gets the data and the view mode passed. And in our case, if you get a paragraph of type Twitter passed, we say, yes, we would like to render and process this paragraph. And if the processor is actually chosen, the addToElement method here will be called. It gets the data, in our case, the paragraph, as well as a prepared custom element passed. Then in the implementation, you just add the data to the element. You can set the slot like that, and you can just set attributes like that with the API. And that's it already. For creating new custom element objects, there's also a very easy to use API. So there's the helper method create on the custom element class, which you just can call statically to create a new element. You give it the element tag name. And from there on, you can use the Fluent API to set attributes and set slots. In case they are like nested custom elements, there's also like some helpers for that. So there's like set slot from custom element, which you can just pass some nested custom element. Or there are also helpers like add slot from nested elements, which you can just pass an array of custom element objects, like an array of paragraph custom elements. Then another module involved is the Lupus custom elements renderer. So the custom elements module, it really just provides the foundational API for providing the tree of custom element objects, for example, for rendering an entity. But then the Lupus custom elements renderer, it really is the module which takes care of turning Drupal into an API backend, which provides custom elements to the frontend. And it does that by integrating with Drupal's routing system. So it defines a new format, just custom elements. And when a route is declared to support that format, the routing system automatically will invoke it in case you access Drupal by specifying the format custom element as an URL parameter, or you make it default. Like the module has an option which allows you to configure in settings PHP that you want to have custom elements format as default, but this is very convenient for just configuring two multi-site in Drupal settings PHP, like one for your admin backend and one for your API backend, which always is rendering into custom elements. And then once your controller is invoked, you return your tree of custom element objects there. So this would be a very simple controller, which just returns a very simple custom element object called Drupal markup, which just outputs some string. So the Lupus custom elements render module, it makes use of the custom elements module to support all canonical entity routes out of the box. So all those pages like node one and so on, they will just work with custom elements. Based upon that, it generates JSON responses with the page metadata and the content, which are the custom elements. So the page data it sends with a response besides the custom elements is like things that like the title, the meta tags of a page, the link relations, the breadcrumbs, Drupal messages, also things like the local tasks and an arbitrary array of settings. So this is like the Drupal settings of Drupal's JavaScript system. So you can just transfer some arbitrary settings to the frontend if needed. So the content, as mentioned, is the tree of custom elements, and that content actually may be serialized just in a string of markup, or you may also choose to serialize it into JSON. So you just get a tree of nested JSON objects. And then finally, you can also switch the content format with a URL parameter of JSON or markup. By default, it's using markup, but that's also configurable. So maybe let's have a quick look at some real example responses. So I've prepared a short demo site here. You see it's a rather naked Drupal 9 installation. I've prepared one article here. Maybe you can take a quick look. So the article actually has just title, tags, image, and I also added paragraphs in here. And there are a few text and quote paragraphs. So really simple. Now let's have a look at the custom element response. So I just append now the format custom elements. And now I will see the response. It's formatted in JSON. You see all the page metadata as mentioned, like title messages, the breadcrumb home is here, some meta tags, and the content in the custom element markup. You see it's like a rather long string. And since that's not so nice formatted, maybe let's better have a look at the JSON variant. So I'll just add content format JSON as URL parameter. And I will see the content here now represented as a nested tree of JavaScript objects. So you see each custom element just gets an element key and all the attribute and slots will be just passed as like nested objects. For example, here the paragraphs, PG text, PG quote, all the data is here. So based upon that data, the frontend then can do its work. As I mentioned before, supporting layouts is also something that is important for us and that just works very nicely with custom elements. So the custom elements module also has out of the box support for rendering entities using the layout builder. So that works actually by special blocks which you can implement which just return custom elements. And since a block always has to return a Drupal render array, you simply have to wrap it in a Drupal render array by calling custom element to render array on it, and then you return this in your block. The custom elements module figures it out and will actually take over the custom element and make a nice tree of custom elements out of it. If you have regular blocks in your layout, that would work as well. It would just obviously not render into custom elements markup, but it gets early rendered using the Drupal render API, and it gets wrapped in a Drupal markup custom element. Actually, the custom element module also provides helpers for that, like set slot from render array. Okay, maybe let's have a closer look at on the front-end side of things. As mentioned, we really decided to go with Nuxt.js in the front-end. So maybe really shortly an introduction to Nuxt.js. As mentioned, it's a Vue.js framework. And like Vue.js, it's really easy to get started. It's performant and it's really enjoyable to work with. It includes all the needed stuff for fully fledged applications. So it does all the JavaScript transpilations, can also handle the CSS pre or post processing. And it also implements routing in the front end with automatic code splitting, which is really nice. So you don't have to take care of all those performance optimizations yourself. It can run into a single page application mode or universally. So single page application mode would mean it's just a very small JavaScript application shipped and then all the rendering happens client side. And with universal mode, you actually have two options to render things. You can use the server side rendering as mentioned, or you use the static deployment and you leverage more the Jamstack approach. But what also makes it a really good and nice fit with Drupal is that it's also modular and it has modules like for generating a progressive web app for your front end, integrating things like Google Analytics, rendering into EMP, or like integrating libraries like Axios. So there are a lot of useful modules available, what's really convenient actually. So how are things looking in the front end concrete? Like if you take an example, simple text paragraph, custom element like that, you can render this in the front end with a view component, which you just called exactly the same name. Maybe if you look back here, the custom element name, it's PG text, it's cap uppercase, and then here the view component has to be called exactly the same name. You can just transform cap uppercase to camel case, which is also done by the system automatically. So PG text in camel case will be automatically picked up here. So the slots of my PG text, we have here slot title, slot default. They are now available in my template. So I can use here the default slot, the markup will be just embedded here, and I use the title slot here. But the title slot, I wrap it into an H3, but only if it's really used. So if it's empty, we'll skip the H3. So this really is a regular view component. You can leverage all the view functionality here. And that way, obviously, you can also add your styles. You can have PostCSS or SAS in here, it's scoped, and you can also add your JavaScript in here. So thanks to that view single file components, everything is really nice and self-contained. So let's have a look at how authentication can work. As mentioned, we really want to use what Drupal provides us with. So we want to use the cookie-based authentication. And actually, just for some editorial and admin login, we also can just go with the Drupal login in the backend. So we can also leverage that. If you would require some login in the frontend, that's something that you would typically customize and make nice in the frontend anyway. And then you can use Drupal's APIs to do the login. But now, how do we have the authentication information in the frontend so we can have nice things like contextual links and edit links and things like that? So for that, we need to share the session cookie between the frontend and the backend. So we can do this with having like the backend being Drupal, setting the cookie when the user logs in at the regular user login page. The cookie needs to be set at the shared domain, like on the root domain of your application, in this case, example.com. And then the frontend, it needs to run on a subdomain below of this domain, like www.example.com, where we run our Nuxt.js application. It can either run in server-side rendering mode or in static. So for the backend, actually, that needs to allow the cross origin requests from the main frontend. So you need to configure Drupal to allow those requests. Or an alternative is actually to just configure Drupal to listen on the slash API or to proxy those requests to your backend. And the proxying is something that you can configure on the web server level, or it's actually also very easily configured with a Nuxt.js module called Nuxt.js proxy. That's also very convenient, also in particular for development environments. So how can you set up all those things? Actually, in the backend, I think it's quite obvious, you need to install the Drupal modules. But in the frontend, there are like a little bit more moving parts involved. So we figured, well, let's also make that easy. And I'm happy to introduce now a new Nuxt.js module. Nuxt.js Drupal custom elements really makes it easy to connect your Nuxt.js frontend to your custom elements backend. So for that, we have prepared two repositories. First one, there is the repository for the connector module. And there's also a small, really easy and empty Nuxt.js project, which demonstrates how the things are working. So you can have a closer look at this after the presentation and reach out to me for questions if you have any. So for getting started with that, basically all that's required is that you install the module in the backend. So you can just require the Lupus CE renderer in the backend. It will automatically also install all the dependent modules as you know it from Composer. You enable the module and actually the backend is ready. In the frontend, you can start from scratch by adding and creating a new project using the Nuxt app. And then you install the Nuxt.js Drupal custom elements connector module, and then you have to enable the module in the Nuxt configuration, and that's basically it. Right now, you actually need to copy over also some scaffold files, but that's also like a process that we are about to automate and to make more convenient. But right now, you need to also run a custom command for that, which you will find in the README of the Nuxt module. Then you run npm run dev to launch the Nuxt development server, and then it's actually running. Maybe I will also shortly show how this looks like. Here I have like the Drupal site, and this is already running, but I can also like show it for this Drupal site and how to launch the dev server. So here I pass just the base URL it needs to take for the dev server. I launch it. It tells me actually to which Drupal it is communicating. Here it outputs the Drupal URL. In my case, my Drupal 9 playground, and the server is running. In my case, I access the dev server not via localhost, but via another domain, because else the authentication won't work. So you see it works, but authentication is not working because I've prepared it to go via that URL, which has the shared cookie information. With that URL, I can go to node one. I have the shared cookie, and you see I'm even authenticated because I get the Drupal tabs in here. You also see I have like very basic empty page, which is rendering like the main custom elements. We can have a look at how this actually looks on the network console. So if I open the page, you'll see there are like a few requests. Like here, there's the request to the backend. And here you see all the data and the data which is rendered here. There are like a few paragraphs, as mentioned, like here are the text paragraphs, the quotes, and we have them very simply rendered here in the frontend. So the frontend here is on purpose very simple, so that's quite easy to see how things are working. So you can just check it out in the GitHub repository and play with it a little bit if you like. Okay. Maybe let's have a short look at how performance and caching works out. So for handling cache metadata, it actually really works how you would expect it from Drupal. The custom element class just implements the usual cacheable dependency interface, which means you will have the usual add cacheable dependency, add cache tags, and related methods available. And then from there, the cache metadata is just bubbled up the custom elements tree during the rendering of the custom elements. So that's just very easy, simple, and straightforward. So you don't have to take care of anything special here. There are methods like add cacheable dependency, you pass the dependencies, make sure the dependencies are there, and the system will take care of the rest. Then for caching, actually, we really, and I think it's actually a good idea to really focus on caching requests. So that way you can leverage Varnish, CDNs, page cache, and for authenticated requests, you can leverage dynamic page cache. What's actually quite good and important to do, because there's no render cache. So there's no Drupal render API used. So there's no render cache. And also there's like no things like a lazy builder. So when you wanna move things to like out of the main request so that you can, so you have a better cache hit usage. Basically you just move the data to a separate request and you lazy load in the front end. So when you compare things now to the Drupal render API, so you really can use the custom elements tree as an alternative. But it's obviously, it's way simpler and limited compared to the Drupal render API because it has a more focused use case. So there are no special hooks like so that you can hook into the process of rendering. There are no process hooks, pre-render or anything. There is no theme because there's no templating involved that's in the front-end application. There is no render cache or lazy builders. So it's really, just simpler. Well, that also makes it easy to work with. So there are no unexpected side effects. It's just a tree of custom element objects and it will be rendered that way. There are no unstructured arrays. It's a tree of typed objects. It handles your cache metadata without any magic. It just collects the metadata of the tree. And it all works with requests, what makes it actually very easy to debug and work with and also very easy to cache. You have the cache metadata on the request if you turn that on in Drupal, so that's also very easy to optimize the cache metadata with that. And maybe also as comparison to the using the JSON API of Drupal core, I think it's particular shines when you wanna have editorial controlled paths there, so you don't have to mess with additional modules like decoupled router and sub-request modules and configuring and making that all fly so that you can answer requests in a simple response. Well, that's just out of the box with rendering Drupal into custom elements markup. It also has things like layout builder support, which is very convenient. And something that what I really like about the approach also is that your custom elements, so like which custom elements you have, then the definitions of the attributes and slots the custom elements use, they basically become the contract between your backend and the frontend. So that really enables also parallel development of the frontend of the backend, what's actually really good. And so you have a clear and defined contract and the backend and the frontend can evolve separately. Yeah, like that's been my presentation. I've compiled here the main links again for you to look up afterwards. We have also now started the Slack channel in the Drupal Slack hash custom elements. If you have any questions or want to have support, please join there. We are there and happy to help you out and answer any questions. Also on Friday, don't miss the contribution opportunities. There's a sprint and there is like the Slack channel Drupal contributions, but of course as well, we are at custom elements. And if you're interested in working and helping with the modules or testing things, join us there. Also don't forget to fill out the survey at the end of the session. And now maybe let's have a look at the questions. I think we have about 10 minutes left. And if there are any questions to be answered, let's check them out. Okay. So one of the questions here was from Antanasius, how is this compared to contenta? So I think it basically compares to contenta, how I mentioned it compares to JSON API, but I haven't had a look at contenta very recently, so I don't know about all the modules in there in detail. But I think the main difference is really that with contenta, you more have an API which provides you the content, but it doesn't necessarily go with the assumption that you have Drupal controlling your paths. But with the custom elements approach, it's like really Drupal is controlling still the path handling, and the front end is just taking over the rendering. So another question was, how do you communicate the data structure between the backend and the front end? Is the front end still blocked on backend implementation progress, or are there easy way to mock data structure so that the front end devs can work with it? Yeah, actually, as mentioned, the custom element definition makes it possible that you can start and do the development in parallel. And that's also something that we do in practice. You just start with example markup in the front end, and you go with that, and you can develop your front end component separately. We really like to do this with Storybook, which makes it very easy for front end developers to work with that, regardless of the backend being ready or not. But actually, I have been experimenting with just saving the responses of Drupal like as static files, and have the front end run with full Drupal page responses, which are just static. So that's like really nice, as you can test your front end application like really without requiring a Drupal to work, and it will get the same data structure as in production later. I hope I was able to answer that question. So next question is, how is your experience with this approach regarding SEO? Can all search bots already understand custom elements? At least some search engines like Bing still not render JavaScript. Do you recommend server-side rendering? Yeah, if you care about SEO, it's probably the best to make some server-side rendering or static pre-rendering. So there really just is the final markup delivered to the browser and also to the robot. It should also be possible actually to just provide a page responsive custom element markup. And we have also doing this in the past on some projects. Since custom elements are just stripped away by search engine because they don't know it, they just strip them away and just look at the content of the custom element. That's also something that's working, but I cannot really tell for sure how good for SEO this is. So if SEO really matters for you, I would recommend to actually go with server-side rendering or static pre-rendering to be sure. And fortunately, that both options are quite easy with Nuxt. So how did you get the tabs view added etc rendered in the front end? So maybe let's take another look at the response for answering that. Here I have in the example, you see there are local tasks actually sent with the page response. So the request here, it's authenticated. It has the cookie set, the session cookie. So Drupal is handling that request with authentication. So in Drupal, we have the regular access permissions and the Lupus custom elements renderer before it returns the page. It also just adds the local tasks to the response. So when I would be logged out, which maybe can show you quickly. So I'll just log out here and open it again. You see now the tabs are gone. And when we look at the response, the local tasks, they are now empty because now the response is not authenticated anymore. you might think that's bad for caching, for authenticated caching with dynamic page cache. Actually, we made sure this works out nicely, and the module is adding the local tasks after the cache is retrieved from dynamic page cache. So if your dynamic page cache is not user specific, it will still be cached very nicely. Yeah, I think we're running out of time now. I actually will have a look at all the questions after the session as well, and answer the remaining question in writing. So you can come back to the session later on and find your answers there. And for anything more, please feel free to reach out to me. I will be around at DrupalCon, and also there's the Custom Elements Slack channel. See you there. Bye.